We get done with that, we'll go right into You Lift It High. So be ready for that, Frankie. All right, pre-worship. Thanks, man. Good morning, church. Welcome to St. Paul's. It's a beautiful morning that we gather. How beautiful was yesterday? Can we talk about that for a second? Wasn't it a beautiful day that we were given? I hope that you used it in some way to connect with family or friends. And this morning, let's do the same thing. Church, I invite you to stand as you're able. We're going to get things going in our worship today. This one's going to call you outside your comfort zone. Are you all ready for that? This is the Yes, Lord song, Brett. You ready? It's one of these. I saw Lindsay doing this. Lindsay, you want to come up here and lead these people on what they're supposed to do? She gave me a hard no. That wasn't even like maybe. That was like, no, I will not. Let's get it going. Come on, church. Now get on the beat now. You speed it up, Lily. Get on the beat. There it is. Let's sing it. Here we go.
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
Here we go.
We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
You did all right. You gotta wake up this morning. I'm pressed.
I am pressed but not crushed. Persecuted, not abandoned. Struck down but not destroyed. I am blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure. His joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow will last for the night, His joy comes with the morning.
Get those hands clapping now. Come on.
Down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord.
All right, you know what to do. We say
yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
Here we go.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Amen.
One more time. Here we go.
We say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
This band up here. Y'all sound good this morning. Let's keep it going. Lift it up.
Day, tonight, you can turn the dark into light. You can take a soul that was lost, turn it around. Lord, on my own, heart can turn as hard as stone. You can make it tender again with your love.
Come on.
Stir up a hunger, stir up a hunger. Nothing will satisfy me, nothing else will do.
Nothing but you, Lord, stir up a
hunger. A hunger in my heart, stir up a hunger in my heart for more of you.
All right, lift it up again.
Turn the dark into light. You can take a soul that's lost. Turn it around. Turn it around, Lord. Lord, on my own, I can turn as hard as a stone. stir up a hunger in my heart. Nothing will satisfy me, nothing else will do. Stir up a hunger, a hunger in my heart. Stir up a hunger in my heart for more of you.
Stir up a hunger, just our voices.
Stir up a hunger, stir up a hunger in my heart. Nothing will satisfy me, nothing else will do. Stir up a hunger, a hunger in my heart. Stir up a hunger in my heart for more of you, for more of you, for more.
Church, will you go to God in prayer with me, please? Gracious God, we thank you for that message. We pray that it might be true this day. God, that within us you might stir something, like there's something missing, God, that we can find in you, that we can seek you out. God, we know that you're there, but at times we get distracted, we get irritable, and we forget that there's a good, good Father that we can lean on. God, you are there for us in our time of need. Never let us forget that, God. Allow us to be open to your presence in this house this morning. And all your children said, amen. We're going to keep our praise going, but church, I want you to pause for just a second and notice, look around you. Look around you. Did you see that there are people with you? There's a fellowship of believers right here today. And this might call a few of us out of our comfort zone, but as my mother always told me when I was a kid, believe it or not, I was a really shy child. I'm not kidding. I'm not. Am I kidding? This is my much younger brother. Doesn't he look older? Never mind. But he can attest, right? I was a very shy child. I was a bit of a mama's boy. And my mom always used to say, there was a saying, well, there's a lot of sayings in my house. A few of them I can repeat. But she used to say, God doesn't call you to be comfortable. Okay? And so this morning we might step out of our comfort zones, and I'm going to ask you to do something we haven't done in a while. I'm going to invite you to share a word of greeting with those around you in the name of Christ. And when you come back together, would you find a seat and rest in his presence this morning, and we'll continue to worship him. Would you do that, church? Would you share a word of greeting with those around you? It's going to get loud in here, y'all. Don't go far. Sea Bear. Okay. He's on the back row back here talking to the bald guy. He's got a beard. He's in the last. He's Doug. He's at the very back, back there. Tell him Dad says hi. His name's Doug. He's back there. Just go back there and say Doug. He's way back here. The last chair. Say hi to Mason. Mason. There's a guy at the back row. He's in the back of this side, last row. His name's Doug. Go say hi to him. Say hi to my dad. Do that, please. Thank you. What a joyful sound that is, church. Well, as we continue our worship, church, I want to call your attention to something. And that's, do you know what next Sunday is? Anybody know what next Sunday is? What'd you say, Amber? If you didn't hear her, you've got hearing problems. Amber has never been a quiet child. I can attest to that. Well, at least from like 13 on. I can't attest to anything before that. But next Sunday is Grandparents' Day. And we hope that you'll bring your grandparents, or if you are a grandparent, you'll bring yourselves and your grandchildren with you. My grandparents are very dear to me, and yesterday, my mother's parents celebrated their 62nd wedding anniversary. 62 years. They're probably watching right now. Well, actually, typically, Grandma goes to church right now in Grandview, and then she comes home and watches this service. So if everybody will turn back to that camera right back there and say, happy anniversary, John and Diane, on the count of three. One, two, three. And 62 years is no small feat, especially if you've met my grandfather. That's a lot, Grandma. You should be a saint. You are. Here we go. Let's lift our voices up. I've heard thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. You provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. Oh God,
inexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
How God's people said. Amen. We are glad you are here, but we are especially glad for the children in the house this morning. And so at this time, try to get your toes tucked in because otherwise they'll get run over. Come on up, kids. It's time for children's time. Let's go. Oh, they're quiet. That's weird.
Though we don't have school tomorrow. Are we excited? I know, and some of you I just busted out a secret. So with school starting and everything like that, is there some way that a friend has made you feel special? Riley, how did you feel special? Nana makes you feel special? Well, you know, Nanas are awesome. I know, right? Can you guys all do me a favor? Can you guys stand up? Everybody stand up. Okay, now turn and face this wall here. And everybody stick your hand out like this. Like this.
There you go.
Everybody got it? Okay, now stand there. Okay, ready? Oh. Try again. There we go. Okay. He tucked his hand away. Okay, I noticed there that everybody giggled. Was that fun?
Yeah.
No, it wasn't fun? All right. Well, yeah, that's not fun. Surgery is not fun. But sometimes we can make each other feel special, and all I did was I ran by and gave you a five. Does that make you feel special? Because you guys are all amazing. So here's what I'm going to have you guys do today. Instead of going out this door with Miss Gloria, we're going to go out the back door. And if you're sitting on the aisles and you would like a five from a child, put your hand out. So I want you guys to do this. You're going to follow me, and we're going to run down the aisle and around the back. You want to do that? Okay, then you are welcome to walk slowly and not five anyone, okay? Okay. Are we ready? Here we go, guys. Get them. Go, 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 go. Get everybody. Go, go, go. Keep going. Well, then you can stay and sit.
Hi.
than cats. Our scripture reading today comes out of Luke 14, verse 1, and then 7 through 14. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to share a meal in the home of one of the leaders of the Pharisees, they were watching him closely. When Jesus noticed how the guests sought out the best seats at the table, he told them a parable. When someone invites you to a wedding celebration, don't take your seat in the place of honor. Someone more highly regarded than you could have been invited by your host. The host who invited both of you will come and say to you, Bryant and Briley, sit still, thanks. Give your seat to this other person. Embarrassed, you will take your seat at the least important place. Instead, when you receive an invitation, go and sit in the least important place. When your host approaches you, he will say, friend, move up here to a better seat. Then you will be honored in the place of your fellow guests. All who lift themselves up will be brought low, and those who make themselves low will be lifted up. Then Jesus said to the person who had invited him, when you host a lunch or dinner, don't invite your friends, your brothers and sisters, your relatives, or rich neighbors. If you do, they will invite you in return, and that will be your reward. Instead, when you give a banquet, invite the poor, crippled, and lame and blind. And you will be blessed because they can't repay you. Instead, you will be repaid when the just are resurrected.
Thank you, Pastor Allison. Good morning. Welcome to St. Paul's. If I have not met you, my name is Monty, and I'm one of the pastors here, and I would love to visit with you and find out who you are. Thank you for being here. Thank you for choosing to be here on a Labor Day weekend when people are out and traveling. And so we're just blessed that you're able to be here with us today. This passage of Scripture is kind of unique, and I think it's a difficult passage. A lot of times we hear a certain passage of Scripture, and I think we have the habit of reading over it and go, oh, wow, Jesus had a good point. Good job, Jesus. Without really thinking about how that might apply to us. How does that fit into what we're doing in this church, in this location, in this year? When I read something, I have a habit of associating it, and I think you all do too, maybe, but you don't realize it. I read this week that when we stop to think, most of the time we remember. Most of our thoughts are memories. We go back and we correlate something that's happening to something that's happened before, and that's just how our brain works. We spend more time remembering than we do thinking about something new. And when I read this passage, it always reminds me of a particular movie that I watched when I was growing up. Most of you probably won't know what it is, but they did a remake of it. I watched the original 1967 version, which would put it out of reach for most of you. But it was starring Lee Marvin, and it had some wonderful actors, Ernest Borgnine and Charles Bronson and Telly Savalas. It was a great movie called The Dirty Dozen. And it had a wonderful message beyond the story. The crux of it was, and why I relate it, is that an Army officer was given the task of this mission that was pretty much a suicide mission, and they had tried to get other people to take it, and nobody would take it. And so they said to this man, why don't you go get a group of the misfits, the lowest of the low, the criminals, and we'll call it Project Amnesty, and you make the deal with them that if they pull off this mission, we'll commute all their sentences. And a lot of them had life sentences. We'll give them amnesty. And so he created this Dirty Dozen, is what he called it. That's what the movie called it. And as it began to work together and you watched the movie, you saw that something happened, because all of a sudden these men from the lowest walks of life all of a sudden became a family. And they started watching out for each other. And then all of a sudden they had a purpose. And that combined purpose and that combined mission changed who they were. In the end, the mission was completed. Only one of them lived to actually enjoy the amnesty that they were granted. And the reason I'm telling you this is because a lot of people don't know that movie was modeled after a true story. And the true story was actually not 12 men, but they were called the Filthy 13. And it did happen. Sometimes when we reach out to the lost and the least, they can do things that the greatest and the proudest cannot do. If they're given a purpose, if they're given a reason, if they're given a place to belong. Why? I don't know. Maybe because they have nowhere to go but up. Not sure what the reason is, but it's a wonderful lesson. The Pharisees grumbled all the time about Jesus' followers. They did not like the people that were following Jesus. They considered them the lowest of the low. They were pretty much uneducated. They had very little use for the traditions or the pomp and circumstance of the day-to-day religion. They didn't value it. The Sadducees and the Pharisees held them in contempt, regarded them as the scum of the earth. They were the tax collectors and the fishermen and the prostitutes and didn't belong in the church. It particularly galled the Pharisees when Jesus said that the lowest of the low, these people, were going to enter the kingdom of God before the religious people were. Think about that. These people that had given their life to religion, and they're told, no, God's going to open his kingdom to them first. It was a crazy teaching for many of the listeners, yet Jesus made it clear that that's what the heart of the gospel was. When you have a luncheon or a dinner, Jesus said, don't invite your friends, your brothers and your sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they might invite you back and then you'll have been repaid. When you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, those that cannot pay you back, and you will be blessed. Obviously, Jesus had never attended a church growth seminar. Because I've been to many of them, and this is not what's being taught in today's churches or church growth seminars, I can assure you. One of the major tenets of a modern church growth movement has been that successful churches, just like successful businesses, you need to target your market. You need to know who you're reaching. You can't be everything for all people. We hear that in marketing. We hear that in church growth. You've got to target your market. For example, best-selling book, I know most of you have heard of this book, Purpose-Driven Church. It's a wonderful book written by Rick Warren, senior pastor of Saddleback Church in Southern California. But he writes about the target market, and I want you to listen to this. He says, our target here at Saddleback is who we call Saddleback Sam. He's well-educated. He likes his job. He likes where he lives. Health and fitness are high priorities for him and his family. He'd rather be in a large group than a small group. He's skeptical of organized religion. He likes contemporary music. He thinks he's enjoying life more than he did 5 years ago, self-satisfied about his station in life. That's the kind of person that Saddleback Church is geared to reach. What church would not want to reach this person? Seriously. Good job, strong family, healthy, well-educated. Gather enough of people in that demographic and your church is going to be a success, at least a success in today's terms of success. Now, to be fair, Saddleback Church also is the home of Celebrate Recovery, which is a movement that reaches out to help those that are hurting and destructive habits, self-defeating issues. But still, I have yet to listen to a church growth expert that tells me your target audience is the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. And yet that's what Jesus tells us in Scripture. That's what we're supposed to be doing. In Luke 19, verse 10, I've come to seek and save those who were lost. In Mark 2, 17, the well have no need for a physician, but those who are sick do. When he stood up to preach his first sermon, he said, my mission is, he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. It's ironic, don't you think, that this is where Jesus placed his emphasis, on the poor and the blind and those who are oppressed and hurting and broken and not fitting in. And yet those are the last people that most churches are really set up to welcome. As one author put it, church culture in North America today is but a mere vestige of the original Christian movement. It's an institutional expression of religion that's part religion and part club, where religious people can hang out with other religious people whose politics, worldview, and lifestyle match theirs. Unfortunately, I believe that this description of the church hits the nail squarely on the thumb. We want to be around people who are like us. We do, don't we? I do. You do. It's natural. The problem is, it doesn't make it Christian. Gloria and I, oh, she's out there, attend an air show every year in Wisconsin. You all know that. I was just there in July. Every July, they hold this huge air show. I've been a private pilot for 35 years. It's someplace that we enjoy going. It's the largest in the world. 600,000 people during the week go to Oshkosh, Wisconsin, the last week of July. We camp, and the campground there has in excess of 20,000 campsites. That's not people. That's campsites. They estimate 50,000 to 60,000 people in this campground each night. And we go with a group of friends, about 12 or 14 people. And as we cross the border into Wisconsin, we're all on our phones. Who's going to get there first? Get a good spot, because we're all going to set up around. We're going to save spots for everybody. So we can gather in our group. We spend the days at the air show, and then at night, everybody picks a night. You're doing dinner this night, you got it this night. And after dinner, it's always Don and Mary that start the campfire, and we all gather our chairs around in a circle, right? And each group is in their circles. As you walk down the median there, there's campfires every so often, and each group is having quiet conversation and warm fellowship in their own private circles of light. Rarely do campers leave their circles of light and venture out into the darkness. And almost never do they venture from their own circles of light and invade somebody else's circle of light. For each camping group is content in its own circle, safe from the darkness and secluded from outsiders in its own exclusive fellowship. And it occurred to me this year, this is so like today's churches. What a wonderful metaphor for the church. Content in its own circle of light, safe from the darkness and secluded from outsiders in its own exclusive fellowship. And yet these words of Jesus, when you have a luncheon or a dinner, don't invite your friends and your brothers and sisters, your relatives, your rich neighbors. When you have a banquet, invite those that are poor, those that are crippled, those that cannot pay you back, and you will be blessed. What's the master saying to us in this strange teaching? Is he not saying, first of all, that the church is the one institution in society that exists for a group other than the members? It's natural to want to be around people who are like us, but Christ is calling us to do something that's unnatural and to reach out with those who may not be like us, but who may need us. Larry Sarver talks about his days when he was a police officer. He attended a lot of traffic accidents. And he said he noticed after a number of years that the people that attend traffic accidents can divide it into three groups. One group is the spectators. They stay back, don't want to get in the way, just want to know what's happening. And then there's the police officers, and it's their job to assess the situation, to find out who is at fault, what could have been done differently, to assess blame and to give out punishments. That's their job, correct? And then there's the emergency medical folks, who are neither of the first two. It's their job. They don't care whose fault it was. They don't care what somebody did wrong to cause it. It's strictly their job to take care of those that are hurting, bandage wounds, get people out of places where they're trapped, give them encouragement. Show them that no matter who they are, they care about them. Three different groups, all within each particular accident. We have a lot of people in our society in that first group that kind of stand back and say, I don't want to get involved, but I want to know what's going on. And then we have folks that are kind of like the scribes and the Pharisees, and they felt it was their job to police. It was their job to make sure everybody followed the law of Moses, and if somebody stepped outside of that, then they were the first ones to step in and to give out punishments and penance and to assess blame, and you shouldn't have been doing it that way, you should do it this way, this is what the law says, here's all the commandments. That was their job. But Jesus is telling us we're not supposed to be like them. We're supposed to be like the emergency medical folks. We're supposed to step into situations and not worry about how they got there, but worry about how they can get out of there. How can we help? How can we make a difference? How can we be that safe place where people, no matter what situation they're in, feel like they can walk into? David Kinnaman of the Barna Group reports that the unchurched people often have the perception that if they go to a church for help, they're going to be judged instead of helped. And I'm afraid that that's really true much of the time. In Larry Sarver's metaphor, we need to be the medical folks. He wants us to identify Jesus with them, not the police, but the paramedics, taking care of folks that are hurting, providing that area where they can come for help. There's one more thing I think we need to mention, though, and this is a reality. Reaching out is not natural, and it's not easy. It's much easier to be a spectator and to stay back and to whisper about what they should have done instead of that, or how they can get out of that situation if they're only smart, if they'd really try. That's a lot easier than actually getting your hands dirty and taking that next step to make a difference, to be the one, to the hands and feet of Christ. When I arrived here about 5 years ago, I was tasked with helping to create a vision. How do we make a difference in the community that we're at? So we gathered folks and we prayed and we had meetings and prayer walks and we talked and we came up with this vision. I'm going to give you the long version, but the short version is all over the place. Reaching into the community, connecting people with Christ, providing opportunities for them to grow in their faith, and equipping them to serve. It's on the wall when you walk in: reach, connect, grow, serve. And it's in a big circle with arrows, because if you do that, you follow a pathway, and that service means you're reaching out, and it feeds itself. And I think we've done a pretty good job at that, but it's become identified more of a discipleship pathway now than a way that we move into the community. When people come and say, "What do I do next?" we point to the circle and say, "Here's 15 ways we can help you in the connect. Let's do that before we move to grow. Now we've got 12 possibilities for you to grow. Let's move." It's our discipleship pathway. It's a way to plug people in to help them to become the best disciple that they can be. I believe it's time to make the next step. I really do. It's been 5 years, and we've come to a place where I think we as a church, and our church is three services, as most of you know, we're pretty comfortable where we are. We have a lot of people here that we can rely on, that we can count on. And it's time to identify that next step. So we're going to be working on that, trying to articulate what we need to have in our brains so that we can actually be the best church that Christ needs us to be in, right here, this location, this time, this year, in this church. I'm going to ask you to pray for that process. Several of you have helped me tremendously, more than you will ever know, just by sharing your feelings. I've had people that have written me some notes and some letters in the last couple of months, and has given me a tremendous insight about your hearts and where you think that we should be headed. Pastor and Allison and I have talked, we've been praying, and we're trying to work on identifying that next step. And we're getting there. Before the end of this year, We will present this to the leadership team for confirmation, and we will present it to you. And it will be our new vision, and it has to be done by the end of this year. All right? Because January 1st is January 1st what year? And we need to have 2020 vision. So we will have a new 2020 vision by January 1st to help us look at our ministries and to filter and to define and be the church that Christ wants us to be. Now, does that mean that we can't do it with our friends? Oh, absolutely not. That's not what I'm saying. Not what I'm saying at all. It's wonderful when we have the folks that we love and we see. And today, we're going to do a couple prayer quilts as we stand up for each other and we pray for each other and we're there to support each other. But if we just do that part, we're a club. When we take those friends and we turn outward and we make a difference outside the walls, then we become ministry. That's what Christ has called us to do. So I'm going to ask you to pray. And remember this passage, because it talks about what Jesus wants for every person in this world. Rich and poor, seeing and sightless, athlete, physically disabled. He wants them to find a safe place, a secure, a happy place in his family. A place to belong. And he doesn't want anybody left out. And we will do our best to be that church as we move into 2020. When you give a luncheon or a dinner, he said, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. When you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame and the blind, and you will be blessed. Today we will celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. We will do that as a family. We will do that together. You'll notice there's some black boxes. There's a couple left up here. We've had several of them throughout the day. Those belong to some of our congregational care ministers. And once we are finished, they will take those elements out to people that are homebound that would like communion and provide that for them. So as we bless our sacraments today, we're doing it for those that are here and those that are not physically present but will receive. Today also, as you come forward for communion, and let me say as I always do, communion in this church, this is not a Raymore communion. This is not a Methodist communion. This is Christ's table, and it's open to absolutely anybody that would like to join us today. As you come forward, I've got two prayer quilts. These quilts are, for those of you that might be guests today, these are made by a group here within the church, and we hear of a need either within the church family or outside of the church family. We bring out a quilt, and we invite people to come and pray for that person for when it's serious prayer is needed, to tie a knot and to pray for that need, and then we literally cover them with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of prayers. These have been a wonderful ministry and an opportunity for us to reach in the community and stand with each other through some difficult days. We have two quilts. This quilt in the back here is for a couple, Nancy and Terry Schuler. They attend a traditional service, bless you. And Nancy in December was diagnosed with a form of cancer, and she's been battling that. And a couple weeks ago, she was labeled cancer-free, and that next week, her husband was diagnosed with cancer. So they are beginning that battle again, and they are in need of prayer. I ask you to pray for that family. This quote in the front is for John Christ. Many of you probably know them, very active within the church and within submissions that we have. Again, a very difficult diagnosis. He begins treatment this week, and these folks need prayer. Does it matter if you know these people? It does not matter. God knows these people, and we believe that God hears prayer. So if you'd like to join us for communion or not, we still invite you to do this and to come up and to tie a knot and to say a prayer. It's your choice, but it's God's table, and it's open to all. At this time, I'm going to ask you to join me in prayer as we bless the elements that have been provided for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this day. We thank you for your presence here in this church at this time. We thank you for those that are watching online as we speak and those that will be watching at a later time. We pray this morning for those that are struggling, those that are hurting, those that are lost, those that are broken, those that you intend for us to reach. Lord, give us the courage to be all that you need us to be. Give us the wisdom to know the difference. Give us the strength to reach out and to gather with our friends and our fellow members of our families to make a difference for those that we don't even know. Thank you, God, for this day, and we pray for the folks that are going to be receiving these quilts. We lift up a special family today that I didn't mention, the Creason family. Many of you know Daryl and Gail, and they need prayers for peace this morning, too, as they go through a transition. So please pray for them this morning. We ask you to be with us here today and in this holy meal. Provide for us all that we need to be. We come here and we gather in your name and we bow before you. We remember the history. We remember all that you have done. The times that we have walked away and you've been there steadfast 100% of the time, God. We come today and we remember when Jesus ascended and yet promised to be with us always. Remember on the night in which he gave his life for us, he took the bread and he gave thanks to you and he gave it to the disciples and he said, "Take, eat all of you. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the meal was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks to you and he gave it to the disciples. And he said, "Take, drink, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father. At this time, we open our hearts and we lift up the prayer that Jesus taught us all when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." As we are all one, the bread that you break is a sharing of the body of Christ. And the cups over which we give thanks are a sharing of the blood of Christ. If our servers would come forward, please. Table has been set right down here, and all are invited. At this time, we're just going to kind of come from the middle up here and around on the outsides. If you're not sure how to do that, just follow the person in front of you.
Sustainer, beginning and end, all powerful, unchanged.
Search me, God, and know my heart. Know my every anxious thought. When I sit, when I rise, you order and you shape my life. So use me, Lord. Take this life, take it all. To make you shine. I'm beautifully broken. My life has been spoken for. I'm yours. I'm yours. I'm yours. You are the light in me. Song I see, Creator, Sustainer, beginning and end, all powerful, unchanging, a constant friend. You search me, God, you know my heart, you know my every anxious thought. When I sit, when I rise, you order and you shape my life. So use me, Lord. Take this life, take it all to make you shine. I'm beautifully broken. My life has been spoken for. I'm yours. Sustainer, beginning and end, all powerful, unchanging, a constant friend. You search me, God, and know my heart, know my every anxious thought. When I sit, when I rise, you order and you shape my life. So use me, Lord, take this life, take it all to make you shine. I'm beautifully broken, my life has been spoken for. I am yours. No matter where you've been, and When you spent some chasing worthless treasure, discovered you can't buy forever. Never thought you'd feel so alone. It's time to come home. It's time to come home. It's time to embrace the love of the Father. It's time to come home. It's time to come home. Time to live a new life, change my grace into race. It's time to come. Heart, you lost sight of your dreams. Felt a burden so heavy, you're torn apart at the seams. When the world is crumbling all around you, lost so much and now you found you. Just can't face this life on your own. It's time to come home.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we prepare for our offering, I'm going to ask you to go to the Lord in prayer with me, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your presence in our lives. We thank you for all that you provide. Help us to truly appreciate and understand and acknowledge that all that we have comes from you. Give us the courage to present back to you in order to help those that are struggling. Lord, we ask you to provide what we need for the ministries that you set before us. Accept our gifts. Accept our hearts. In Christ we pray. Amen. And for ushers, we'll prepare for the offering, please.
It's time to come home. It's time to come home. It's time to embrace the love of the Father. It's time to come home.
Church.